look at the cost of the consumables, definitely, because they are a recurring cost, and if the consumable of a machine costs less, you're going to save over a longer period of time. And when you are negotiating for best value, we all look at the cost of the equipment. Some of the things that can help you is to get volume discounts. If you and a couple of your friends can make a deal together, you will get a volume discount. You can negotiate on free accessories, that what additional free things the company is ready to give you along with the machine. Another component of negotiations can be the extended warranty, that instead of the standard 1 year, if they can give you 1 year additional warranty, which is again a money saved for you, and any other freebies that can be given. Don't miss to look in between the lines about the tax. Is it included? Is the packing freight included in that? Is it CIF, FIB? Are the accessories included in that? These are the minor, smaller things which you need to look at it. And once you have looked at that, then you are set to place the order, which should always be written. And please read all the documents thoroughly and ensure you understand all the terms used by the supplier. Be sure that you have a committed timeline by the supplier. Do keep the training of the staff in your mind when you are buying equipment. And after this, then once you have the product information, then you have the quote, that is the offer by the company. Then you get an invoice. Invoice is a sort of a commitment to buy. And once you have purchased it, then you will get a bill for it, and then you will get a receipt. And if you are importing it, you will get a bill of entry and air bill. Now, from accounting purposes and documentation, it's important to have all these documents with you. You don't know at what time you will be needing it. And now it is mandatory that the bill of the entry and air bill has to be submitted to the bank. Otherwise, there are serious issues with that. So your purchase order that goes from your side should be in detail, and it should be documented and written. Whatever verbal communication you had with the dealer or the supplier or their person, you must put it in black and white in your purchase order, because that is what you are expecting to be delivered to you. It should have the exact catalog number, the make, model, detailed description of the item, quantity, unit cost, tax, custom duty, warranty, guarantee, and any freebies that have been decided on should be included into the purchase order. And this is how a quotation looks like, which the company has sent. And this is the next pages of the quotation. And this is how the purchase order goes from our side, where we referring to the quotation, we'll be placing the order. And then we come to the stage of the supply, and then you have, this is the CIF. CIF is cost, insurance, freight, everything included to your doorsteps. For sometimes there may be additional charges by the cargo people for clearance. This is how the bill of entry and this is how the airway looks like. And once you get the equipment, there is always a packaging list with that. Compare this list with your purchase order and make sure that the packing list does correlate and is exactly the same as your purchase order. This is the total packaging list that has come. And make sure once the machine is delivered, you do not open the package. This is very, very important, because many times your new toy has come and you're very keen to open it and see that what exactly is. Let the supplier engineer do it. And please take the unpacking pictures or video that when the box is opened, because if there is any breakage or missing part, you will have a documentary proof that. And then again compare it with the packing list. Always assign one responsible person from your organization who will be a person concerned with that particular equipment, who will be taking care of all the logistics, all the paperwork, who will be coordinating the training, who will be looking after the spares, their maintenance, and also anything that is required to be done over the tenure the equipment is with you. And when it is being installed, look at the safety issues. Safety and security need to be looked into, and if you have a biomedical department, they should also look at it. Any issues related to waste need to be taken care of. It's there is any special protection required for laser or something, that also be looked into it. And then there's the training part which is needed. This is an important document. This is the installation report. Everyone would like to get it signed from you. Make sure that you read it thoroughly. And if you find any defect and anything missing, please put it on this document, because this is, will be a reference document about the delivery of the equipment. And then we set to integrate the new equipment with your EMR, whether whatever it is and how it can be integrated into EMR, that is where you set in. The equipment is lodged into the store, and then there is a barcode printed which goes onto the sticker. And this is how we'll be making work instructions for using that equipment, that these are, this is how are the different steps. It's kind of a summary of the instruction manual, and it is in a simpler form, which is the main training tool with us. And it is also a benchmark with which we will compare whether a team worker is working according to what he's supposed to do. So these are the different steps that we have. Like for the EMR, we have to create a vendor, then approve the vendor, then create the item, create purchase order, approve purchase order, print purchase order, and then receive the stock, verify the stock, enter purchase. Now when we are creating the purchase order, and the moment the purchase order is approved, automatically SMS and email goes to the supplier, so we don't have to make a separate communication for that. And then finally you prepare the check, and then complete the whole process. This is also steps putting in a little different way, where you have all the steps covered into it. You have the about the device first, then planning, and then procurement, then installation, and then commissioning of it, and then monitoring the progress for it. Four important things which you need to keep in mind are that look at the right quality, right price, right quantity, and right time. Right quality is very important, where the description, specification, all these things you will be going into. Right price, of course, definitely everyone would like to do his best to negotiate and get the right price. And of course, the right value. Again, the right quantity for procurement, is it justified? It should fit your need. Do you need one autoref? Do you need one slip? Or you need five autoref and you need five slit lamps? And again, right time and place. The right time and place for delivery are specific and exact. And logistics of issues such as supply and mode of transport are clearly indicated in that. Thank you so much for your attention. And I will now request Dr. Ritu Arora to let us know about selecting the FACO machine.
I think that was a wonderful talk by Grewal. I think let's give him a big round of applause. And another thing is to think out of the box and having this instruction course. Last time we had it very successfully in indoor as well. And these are all golden messages which you will not get in any textbook. And these are all, I think, by his experience, 4 decades or 5 decades of experience, what Grewal has got, and it's all golden messages, you should take it up. Over to Ritu.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. And I'd like to thank Dr. Grewal for inviting me for his very prestigious IC. So I'll be talking about selecting the right FACO machine. And as we know that since the time FACO was first introduced in the 1960s, the technology has really matured, made huge advances, and has made our cataract surgery, you know, extremely fast, safe, and has given us really good results. In fact, that's what we are looking for, is that with our FACO, we should be able to give a wow factor to our patients. So we do have a plethora of options available to us. Different companies have different levels of FACOs available, and at times it can be quite confusing because we have so much of choice. So we need to understand which are the features which are essential in our FACO machine, which are desirable, and which may be, you know, sort of not really so essential. And how do we get the best from our machine? Most of us tend to go for the machine which we have used during our training period. But as technology keeps changing, we have to update ourselves and know what's available. So we need to look before we leap. And FACO is always going to be, for a newcomer, it's going to be the heart or the core of your practice. It's going to be where you get most of your economics to expand your practice. So we have to look for what is best. Now, need to define, firstly, your budget. So that Dr. Grewal has already spoken about. You need to know, do you have the budget to go for a brand new machine? Would you like to go for a refurbished machine? What are the options? Do you want to do a down payment where you get a nice discount? Or do you want to go for an EMI? Or do you want to go for IOL bundling? So this is something that you need to decide. And according to your budget, you can look for what is best available. So you need to know what is efficient, what are the different FACO parameters, modulations which are available in new features which are available, which make the machine more efficient and make it much safer so that your complications are much less, you get clear corneas on your day one. And at the most important is that you should have a tension-free time. That means you should have a good backup. You should have a good annual maintenance contract or a CMC available so that if there is any breakdown, that can be taken care of. And during your training period, they give you the complete support, which is very essential for a novice surgeon. So what are the choices? The choices is that everyone desires the best. You could go for a fully loaded luxury and top of the model machine if you can afford it in the beginning of your practice, or if you're planning to upgrade and you want to go for the best. Or you can go for a workhorse which has all the essential features, gives you a good enough support, and at the same time does not burn a hole in your pocket. So what are the aspects that you need to look at? First is the kind of pump. You need to look what type of pump are available in the different machines, the fluidic system, the chamber stability software and surge control, which is going to add safety to your surgery. What are the FACO handpiece options available, the FACO powered modulations, the designs of the tip. What is the ease of use, whether it comes with a display, whether the foot pedal is wireless, and the ergonomics. How does it fit into your OT system? And the add-ons, does it have an anterior vitrectomy? Does it come with a posterior vitrectomy? Certain other features which can be useful? And what are the economics and service? And can it be a modular system which you can upgrade as you go on in practice? So vacuum, as we know now, we have moved our FACO technique has moved from a FACO-based surgery more to a vacuum-based surgery. So we need to look at machines which can give us a higher vacuum without causing surge. So you have either the venturi-based systems or you have the peristaltic-based systems. And the peristaltic pump is usually a safer option. Majority of the machines are based on this. And most of the higher end machines have evolved more close to a venturi system where the rise time is very rapid. And here the vacuum, as we know, builds up only on occlusion, so it's much safer. Some of the machines which have a peristaltic pump are the Alcon platforms, the Sovereign, Nidec, APA. So we can, you have time now when you're here at the conference. If you're planning to upgrade, you must go to each of the manufacturers and understand in depth what are the options available. So the venturi pump is much faster. Here the vacuum, as we know, is produced by a compressed air or gas, and the vacuum is instantaneous. So though the surgery is faster, there's always a greater risk of having an inadvertent catching the iris or the PC. And some of the machines, the Stellaris, the Visalis 500, and Constellation are the venturi-based systems that are available. Now we also have the dual pump technology where you have benefits of both the peristaltic and venturi pumps, and you can switch between the two. And the AMO Signature Pro has this option available between peristaltic and venturi, so you can use the best of it. The fluidic system is again something that we need to look into, because optimal fluidic is what is very critical. We have a small space in which we are working. and the balance on the inflow and outflow is what prevents the complication, maintains the chamber stability. And different machines have revolutionized the phacofluidics and have made the procedure much more safe. Now, the major change which has happened over the last few years is that earlier the inflow or the irrigation was always gravity driven and dependent on your bottle height, the tubing, and the bore of the phaco needle. So we often had to use an air pump to pressurize your irrigation. But now you have the pressurized inflow which is available, where you can you have the BSS bag which gets compressed and you can have a target IOP, and thus you can have a much more stable anterior chamber. The outflow, as we know, depends on the aspiration flow rate and the incision leakage. So this, the inflow and outflow, if it is well maintained, then your surgery is going to be safe. Now, the chamber stability and surge control. Surge, as we know, happens when there is a breakage of occlusion. And that leads to a sudden shallowing of the anterior chamber and can lead to a PC rent, or it can lead to the loss of endothelium. So various machines have different built-in mechanisms which we can check out, we should understand, because normally the manufacturers don't really tell you much about how it works. So the change in the pump speed, the change in the vacuum rise time, or the aspiration flow rate at the time of occlusion are some of the ways in which surge can be controlled. And you also do have venting and low compliant tubing and the aspiration bypass system. So understand what is the surge control mechanism in your machine. Now, some of the machines like the Centurion have the active fluidics. As I told you, you have the pressurized BSS. You have special valves which help to prevent the change in volume of the fluid. The AMO signature has the fusion fluidics, where you have the peristaltic and venturi system. And the Stellaris platform, they have the adaptic fluids. So different machines have different features which we need to understand. Then coming to the handpiece, which is actually the heart, as we know, phaco is basically a reverse piezoelectric phenomenon, and the frequency is machine-based. Each machine has a fixed frequency, which can vary from 28 to 60 kilohertz. The lower the frequency, the lesser is the heat generation. The higher the frequency, better is the cutting power, but the downside is that more heat is generated. The phaco power can be varied, which is depending on the stroke length. And you also have different options. Earlier, it was only longitudinal ultrasound that was being used. But now, the later machines have torsional ultrasound and transversal. And this helps to reduce the effective phaco time. You also have different power modulations available in different machines. And that helps to give you clearer corneas the next day. So I'm not going to go into these individual ones. But basically, you need to see the advantages and disadvantages of torsional ultrasound, hyperpulse, burst mode, pulse mode. Understand what are the different parameters. And using these phaco modulations, you can get a better effective surgery. You can reduce your phaco time. You can reduce your phaco power that is being used. And it also helps to have thermal dissipation, because you have a rest time between the phaco pulses. You also have advanced power modulation molds, where you have a variable duty cycle, you have a variable rise time, you can have a occlusion mode which helps to avoid surge. And then coming to the phaco tip design, again you have a large variety of options which are available to us. And depending on the grade of cataract, or depending on the kind of technology that you, technique you use, whether it's a sculpting technique or whether it's a phaco chop technique, you can choose the design according to that. So it's a good option to make a sort of spreadsheet. See the different phaco machines which are available, what are the features which are important to you, and make a good comparison. And so before you take the leap, make sure that you take a demo, you try it on different types and grades of cataract, talk to your peers, get a feedback, be clear on the CMC, AMCs, and what are the recurring costs, whether the tubes are disposable and you'll have a recurring cost for the cassette. See the IOL bundling options, what are the pros and cons, and whether the machine a few years on can be upgradable. So in the end, it's actually the man which is more important than the machine, and the surgery success depends upon you. So whichever machine you have, try to get the best out of that. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ritu, for excellent and exhaustive presentation. We'll have questions at the end of all the presentations. Now I'll request Dr. Ajay Arora, a prolific vitreoretinal surgeon, on his experience and views on buying posterior segment equipment, which, why, and when.
Can I have my slides, please? Thank you, sir. It's thank you for giving me this opportunity. So when you buy an equipment, you should not flicker in your mind the way it's flickering here. You should have to make a decision. You have to be very firm. Right. So, you know, here this is erratic purchases. And this lady here is very organized, selecting every little small thing and deciding and planning out which jyoti she wants. So that's... again gone out. Okay. So, and then you need to negotiate, which Dr. Mohan Rajan will be talking. So these are the equipment you need. I will not be covering everything. It's not possible in 10 minutes to cover everything, but I will cover fundus cameras, OCT, OCT angiography, laser, and vitrectomy machine. So whenever you want to buy, you must know what is the standard of care you want to give, what is the stage of practice you are in, the competence of handling the equipment, edge over the competition, return on investment, desire for excellence, and how much cash you have available. These are the three stages of your practice. The initial stages is when you're a bachelor, you're not yet married to your practice, you're operating elsewhere. Next is stage two, which is an intervention stage where you have to buy other equipment like lasers, vitrectomy machine, wide angle viewing system, and the advanced stage where you want to give cutting edge diagnostics and surgical to your patients. So Dr. Grewal has already covered the return on investment. This is very important. But whenever you buy any equipment, you should go through this cycle. You should put yourself, supposing I want to buy a fundus camera, I should put fundus camera here and go through all these steps and decide which equipment I want to buy. So let me just give you examples. This was the year of 2004 when I joined Grewal Institute, and there was a daisy machine. And I told sir that I'm not comfortable operating on this. So he said, okay, let's go ahead and buy a new machine. So we had an option of Acutus, Doc, Retigar, and Appaswamy. And at that time, he didn't know me well. So he said, okay, let's buy Retigar because it was cheaper and it paid off within a month's period. Normally when you look at equipment, it should pay off in about 3 years' time. So after that, we have moved in that place, bought Acutus, Constellation, and now Heads Up Surgery. Similarly, in Delhi Retina Center, we started our practice in 2004, and OCT was introduced in Indian market in 2006-07. And at that time in 2007, we had options of buying a Zeiss Stratus, a Nidec OCT, and an OptiView, but we decided to go in for OptiView because The guy who came and convinced us, it had all the features, it was there was a lot of data available, Indian data on OptiView, and our decision was good. It paid off in about 11 months time. So whenever you buy an equipment, you should ask these questions called paints. You should do a peer review, popularity, affordability, whether it integrates into your practice, whether you need it today, tomorrow, whether you want to buy a new or old machine, what is the technology, whether you are satisfied with the specs, the services, the standing of the company, and then we go ahead and now I'll come to each and every instrument. So these are various fundus cameras that are available. You have to actually know the specs of all of them before you decide. And then you have an option of Optos, which is a wide-angle viewing system. You have a Heidelberg system, which provides you with a fundus camera and an OCT machine. You have the Eidon machine, and you have a Zeiss Clarus 500 and 700, which is available. So when I want to buy a machine, a fundus camera, I had to ask myself, what do I want? Whether I want portability, I want a non-midriatic or the midriatic system, I want a swivel arm, I want to look through the eyepiece, or I want to just see the screen. I want these features of autofluorescence, angiography, ICG, and how much, these are all standard specs which are there. And then you look at the cost, the service, how does it integrate into your system, and what is your long-term planning in case you want to buy a Zeiss machine, whether you're a Zeiss Forum. So these are the various fundus cameras that are available. These are some of the specs. I will not go through the specs, but you have to know them. So this is the Topcon system. This is the COVA system. So when we set up our practice, we had to buy a lot of equipment. And at that time, I decided against Zeiss, against Topcon. I had used Zeiss before. I had used Topcon before. But I decided to go for COVA. Why? Because I was getting a very good deal. Because I talked to a friend and some other people, and they said that COVA is good. Because I was able to get all the features which I was getting in any other machine at a much cheaper rate, and it was being given by a vendor who was supplying me another equipment. So I had one vendor for two machines, therefore the service component was taken care of, and that is how I decided to buy the fundus camera. Now let's look at the OCTs. So the OCTs, you can have an SD OCT, you can have an SD OCT with angiography, octa, or you can have an SS OCT. So again, you should put every machine into the cycle and see what generates. You should know, you should be talking to a lot of people, you should have the affordability, you should be talking to various users. Then you should talk to them about the whether the service that is being given in your area is good by that particular vendor. So these are the features. So I should see if an OCT which I'm going to buy can take care of all the features which I'm looking for. So these are the various machines. These are the spectral domain OCTs. These are the various OCT angiographies. And they have some differences when you look at the critical features of examination. So we had to upgrade our OCT, which was an SD OCT. And we are a referral practice, so therefore I wanted to buy an Octa. So I got all the vendors to put machines in my clinic. I had Topcon, I had a Zeiss, I had an OptaView, and I talked to my mentor in the US, and he told me, why do you want an Octa? You have to basically look at the fluid, and you have to inject intravitreally. Don't buy an Octa. But then we talked to a lot of people here, and they had different experiences. So it's very important that you internally decide what you want to do, what you are looking for, how will it help in your practice. And if it does, then you look at the affordability, and you look at the maintenance, the service, the suppliers are taken care of. And that is why we went ahead and bought the Zeiss Angioplex. So again, I put through myself into all these points, with the peer review, the affordability, the integration into a long-term system, what is my need today and tomorrow, how good is the technology, what are the specs, and that is what the answer was, that I have to buy this particular machine. Similarly, you have numerous lasers available in the market, and they all have different specs. There's lasers from multinationals and Indian multinationals. Then you have targeted laser by Navilas. You have a micropulse laser. You have a laser with also facility for YAG. So we went and decided to buy a yellow micropulse laser. To some extent, you know, I was influenced by Dr.Grewal in buying this. But then we almost bought it together, because I have a personal experience of working with Aridex for over two decades. I wanted to try out multi-spot technology. We had to spend out a lot of extra money. I knew that yellow wavelength is better, and the supplier was good. The support I'm going to get is very good, and I went ahead and bought an Aridex micropulse laser. Similarly, vitrectomy. In 2004, when we started our Delhi Retina Center, we bought Doc Harmony. Very soon, there was Doc Associate, there was EVA launched, but we stuck to Harmony, and we enhanced our Harmony functions by getting a WIT enhancer in place. So I could do everything what Associate could do, what an EVA could do with a harmony, with a wit enhancer, and with the wit enhancer, I could use the Alcon troker cannula systems, the Alcon cutters, the mid-lapse cutters, which you can't use with DOC. So with the DOC machine, I was using any cutter that is available and being cost effective. In our clinic recently, we were using Aquarius, and then the Aquarius, the service was going to go out of, they were not going to provide service beyond a particular time. So we had to upgrade, and we thought of upgrading to Alcon because of multiple reasons, because where I use the EVA, I use the Alcon, but we went ahead because of various reasons. So it is very important to put yourself to that cycle. There are various vitrectomy machines available, and it's important to come to a conclusion that I want to buy this machine. Now in the accessories, it's important in the Indian market that you have to reuse a lot of accessories. So you have to be judicious. Like I use my own troker cannula system, which uses a hypodermic needle, and we have shown it consistently that this particular troker cannula system is effective, is as good as any multinational, and it is good. So the take-home message is budget your equipment, decide what stage, which equipment you want to buy, decide the brand and the supplier, do a good homework, do not compromise on quality, plan an AMC for about 3 to 5 years, you must train your staff for good maintenance, improvise your system, and where possible, I would go for Make in India. Thank you for your kind attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Ajay Arora, for an excellent presentation and dotting it with your personal experience on decision making, and that was very illustrative that how you took decisions at different levels in your practice for buying the equipment. Thank you so much. We move on to the next talk, negotiating the right deal, which is very, very important. And we couldn't have anyone better than Dr. Mohan Rajan to share his thoughts and experience with us. Dr. Mohan, please.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Dr. Grewal. And it's always a pleasure to be in his course. And every time, I learn a lot from Dr. Grewal, as well as others who have been here with us. And good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Negotiating the right deal, tips and tricks, whatever Ritu, whatever Grewal told now, whatever Ajay told now, all this depends on the negotiation, okay? And how these are my financial interests. Let me see the top 10 as far as the negotiation is concerned. Go to a manufacturer who has got the entire spectrum of ophthalmic equipment, okay? Don't go to a standalone company. For example, the Hoya is a company which deals only with intraocular lenses. Don't go to such companies. Go to companies like Appasamy or Alcon or J&J or Zeiss or something, wherein they have the entire spectrum of equipment. Few companies deal only with the refractive cataract equipments and vitreoretinal machines, and they have the entire spectrum. Because if you are able to buy one, you can get another one free of cost from them. So that is the idea of this entire thing. If you go to a standalone company, then you will not be able to do any negotiation, okay? Because they have nothing to have offer for us. So we can crack the best deal when we buy many products with maximum discounts as well. And one or two products, even off the shelf, they can give it to you free of cost as well. So it depends on how you negotiate with them. Okay, it's like going to, how many of you have gone to China? If you've gone to China, not you cannot go now because of coronavirus, but otherwise you can go to China, and if they sell a product, okay, for 1,000 yuans, okay, and you can get it for 20 yuans. You know that? 20 yuans. You just have to bargain. They'll sell 1,000 yuans, but you can get it for 20 yuans or 30 yuans. So that is the way you can negotiate with these companies as well. Because these companies, please understand, I think the door is closed. You should not go outside because the trade is here nearby. The companies are making huge amounts of profit. They're making 300, 400% profit. If the cost of the equipment is 5 lakhs, they're going to tell you 25 lakhs or 20 lakhs. Okay, so you can bring them down very easily. Don't underestimate that power which is there. Number one, pay upfront, best discount. By paying the amount upfront, we can get the best deal. Okay, you can pay cash. Okay, if you have cash, even demonetized notes, some companies will accept prior to 2016, whatever notes you have, old notes also. The companies will be able to give maximum discount if you pay upfront. If you pay upfront certain amount of money, then they'll be able to give you the maximum discount. You tell them, I'll give you a certain amount of money, you get the, they'll slash down the price from 10 lakhs to 5 lakhs or 7 lakhs if they want to. So this is the pay upfront, number one. Number two is deferred payment. What is deferred payment? Seed money. You pay remaining amount, you pay, they do the payment in installments for 3 to 4 years. No interest. But please understand, cross-check with your colleagues and previous users, okay? Colleagues means colleagues like Dr. Mohan Rajan or Dr. Grewal or Dr. Rajay Arora or Dr. Saurabh, who is sitting here. Because if you go to major guys, okay, that high volume guys, these guys have got a very secret deal with the companies, okay? Don't tell this outside, okay? Right, because I'm standing for chairman also, scientific committee, they'll be this thing. I'm just telling you, don't tell this, but this is where you come and ask us, people like us, because we will get you exactly what price we are getting the lenses for from that company. So we will know exactly what is it. If you go to bigger ones, they'll not be able to tell, because they're all secret packs which the companies makes with that particular company because of the huge volume they are giving. So these are the various machines, Lens AR, Victus, whatever it is you want to buy. Number three is leasing. Leasing is also a valid option, but depends on the product to be bought. For example, if you have a, if you want to buy a femto cataract or a smile or something like that, or femto LASIK, then do the leasing. The leasing is what is done in the US and the Europe. All the companies do the leasing, and you pay the company on the case-to-case basis. Suppose you have done one case, and a certain percentage of that you need to give the company. So leasing is also a good option because it doesn't have a Damocles sword on top of you. Number four is bundling. Bundling is another best way of a best deal. So bundling, that is why I'm telling, go to a company which has got the IOLs, which has got the lasers, which has got the vitrectomy instruments, which has got the phaco machines as well, and which has got the entire gamut of this thing. A lot of companies are available. So they got the IOLs also, they got the viscoelastics as well, and you can bundle the IOLs, you can bundle the viscoelastics, you can bundle the other things also, bundling of other products by the manufacturer, which gives you a better deal. Again, make sure, check with your competitor, with your colleague to find out exactly what is going on. For example, this catalyst machine, what we bundled it with a lot of J&J lenses, the Symphony lenses, and the multifocal lenses as well as the Technis One lenses. Number five is group purchase. Joining with other colleagues, about 10 or 20 of you in your own town or own area of the same wavelength, okay? Same wavelength, you can join together and do something like a group practice, okay? This will give you a best deal. And also the optimum use of the equipment, okay? Again, very important. For example, if you buy an IOL Master 700, it's going to cost you about 20, 25 lakhs or 30 lakhs or 35 lakhs or whatever it is. But I'm just telling you, you can use it only for a certain number of cases in your practice. But if 10 people join, okay, then the usage goes up of that particular thing. And you can also divide the income, divide the, the investment, the capex on that particular equipment as well. So group purchase, like-minded individuals going with the same wavelength and buying the equipment. There are a lot of group practices which has come up in our country because of this, and there's a practice which has been done in the US. Bulk purchase, you assured guarantee of minimum purchase. For example, Agarwal Eye Hospital or the CFS or the Aravind Eye Care System or Shankar Netralaya LEPI, they're able to guarantee, they're able to get the rock bottom price because they're able to give high volumes. Okay, if suppose you are giving 100 lenses, they are giving 1,000 lenses per annum. So because of that, the company is also coming down. So you need to give this thing. We can also get a good deal. Please understand, this bundling is based on whatever you are doing today, not what you are going to do tomorrow. Whatever, suppose you are doing 100 lenses, 100 surgeries, cataract surgeries a month, then you bundle for 50 lenses with them. Okay, don't put unnecessary pressure on you. Okay, and otherwise you'll be working only for the company, right? Whatever you earn, you'll have to give to the company. So that is another thing. Number six, so bulk purchase, as I told you, bulk purchase will be able to get this. And this is only the major institution. Number seven, you become the brand ambassador for that particular company. For example, you become the speaker for the particular company, then you promote their machines, products, pharma. thing, and if you become the brand ambassador, they even give the equipment free of cost for you. Become the live surgery demonstration for that. Many people are doing that, okay? I'm not doing that. I'm just telling you. Above are the best tricks to crack the right deals for this companies as well. Number 8 is competitor. Ask for the rock bottom price, okay? I wanted to buy a Benz car. Those guys told me E-Class Benz is about 65 lakhs. Then I told him competitor Audi A6 is giving me for 50 lakhs. They came down to 52 lakhs for me. From 65 lakhs, I brought it to 52 lakhs, and that is the reason why I have this Benz car now today. Okay, you can bring that. So you have to tell them that my Appa Swami is giving me for 10 lakhs. Why are you charging 20 lakhs? Okay, they'll come down. Or some other company is giving me. Tomorrow I'm getting that machine from them, that company. If you're not going to do it, so don't give that impression that you are doing a favor for them. Okay, actually they are doing a favor for you. This is the other way around, right? You should have the upper hand as far as the negotiating the deals is concerned. If they find that you are a little, weak, then they will try to thrust all the price on you. So you have to make sure that you need to do your maths before, as Grewal rightly said in the beginning, make sure to do your maths before, do your homework before, talk to your friends, and make sure that you get the best deal for those patients. So again, catalysts, all this. Number 9, this many people underestimate. Your own strength is that you are yourself a brand name. That is your USP. Each one of you sitting here, you don't have to be an institute. You are a brand name. Okay, you are a brand name. You are a brand name in itself. It is a USP. Certain companies will sell their products to others by quoting that so-and-so, I'm using this. Dr. Ajay Arora is using this, Dr. Grewal is using this, and because of that. So you are yourself a brand name. So you have to emphasize that repeatedly when negotiating the deals. Have the upper hand, saying that you should be superior to these guys. Please understand, this is a hidden agenda many companies will have, okay? Please don't sign the paper blindly. I think Grewal beautifully mentioned that as well, okay? One is important thing is go through that. They might put 50 lenses, but when they come with a sheet for you to put the signature, they would have put 100 lenses, 150 lenses. Okay? And also, the CMC, AMC, everything has to be included right in the beginning. Okay? On the negotiating deal. When you negotiate the deal, when you buy the equipment, annual maintenance contract, comprehensive maintenance, because these guys fleece you in comprehensive maintenance contract, annual maintenance contract. Okay, for example, the femtolasic machine, we are paying about 55 lakhs annual maintenance contract. It's very high. Okay, similar to that, the catalyst machine also. So you, right in the beginning, you negotiate. 5 years, I will not pay you AMC. Don't underestimate your power. That is the reason why I'm telling these companies are obliged to do it for you, because they're making huge profit. They want more customers, and they want to make sure, okay? And that is the thing. Ultimately, you can have a very beautiful, nice, enjoyable life. If you don't negotiate properly, then you'll be working for the company and become a drunkard like this. Thank you very much for the wonderful opportunity. And if you're not voted, please do it tomorrow. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mohan, for all the polls. So selected intelligently, and I'm sure they are going to be of benefit to everyone. We move on to the next, which I think is the most important component that finally decides the results of the cataract surgery, other than the machine and everything, is the biometer. And we have Dr. Saurabh Chaudhary from IOCare to share his experiences about the biometers.
Thank you. So after all these talks, I'll be talking about something very basic. That's a biometer, and biometer is what everybody needs, and because they have to do a cataract surgery. So before I start off, I would want to say why are we talking about a biometer? A biometer is because cataract surgery currently has become a refractive surgery. The norm is to give patients spectacle dependence, independence, and if they're spectacle dependent, then they're not very happy. This is a testament of the increasing use of multifocal and toric lenses. So what is biometry? Biometry includes basically two or maybe three main components. One is the power of the cornea. That's what we're calculating. That's the keratometry. The other is the axial length. And this data is being used to determine the ideal intraocular lens power by using the appropriate formulae. So there are three main things: the keratometry, the axial length, and the formulae. And that's what we need to look into when we're deciding about a biometer. But the final visual outcomes are dependent on precise IOL power calculations. So this slide, I've put it across to say that if there is a one if there is a error in calculating the keratometry by one diopter, there'll be a 0.9 diopter of error in the IOL power. And similarly, if there's a 1 millimeter error in calculating the axial length, that's going to transform into a 2.5 diopter error in the IOL power. So that is 1 millimeter is a huge thing what we play around with, and you need to use the appropriate formulas. So first is the keratometry, and what keratometers should be, what are the available keratometers in the market? There are manual keratometers, those are the Bausch & Lomb types, the Jabal Schwartz types, which were, we read quite a bit about them. I'm not very sure if it's available right now. Then there are the autokeratometers. Then the keratometers incorporated in the optical biometers. That's the IOL Masters and the Lens Stars and a lot of other optical biometers which are available now. Then there are other topographically based keratometers which will give you on the effect of a placebo-based or the elevation-based topography. So autokeratometer is based on the principle of focusing the reflected corneal image onto electronic photosensitive device which instantly records the size and computes the radius of the curvature. It is slightly better than the manual K theoretically because it measures the central 3 millimeter zone. But which keratometer do we need to choose? There's a Bausch & Lomb type where various Indian manufacturers are there, and you can actually choose one, varies from 35,000 to 50,000 Indian rupees. They're all reliable, very easy to calibrate, and good service backup. So a keratometer, a manual keratometer, a must in your practice, in spite of the fact if you have a autokeratometer as well. What are the advantages of an autokeratometer? It's easy to use. You don't have to calibrate it, but you just need a service out of it. Patient fixation is slightly better, and it is reproducible. And it's becoming the standard now to use an autokeratometer. But you need to look at the above points crucially. The cost here goes up to about 1 lakh rupees, which are just the basic Chinese models which are available, to up to 3,50,000 rupees. And when you are thinking about doing a refractive cataract surgery, you should think about a good keratometer here as well. Now, there have been a few studies comparing head-to-head the manual versus the autokeratometer. So the message across is that autokeratometer is not a must, because this paper here, which was in the Bioscience Biotechnology Research Journal, it did say that there were insignificant differences between the two methods, and the only advantage of the autokeratometer was quicker evaluation, and values are not influenced by skill of the operating person. Now coming down to the next bit, and I have put it down again here, that 1 millimeter error leads to about 2.5 error in the post-operative refraction. The two types, optical and ultrasound. So the ultrasound keratometers we all know about is using ultrasound, like the A scans what we have. Basically two techniques to do it. One is the immersion and the contact technique, and I'll speak a little about that. And then there are the optical biometers. So that's the A scan what we're talking about. So the A scan or the regular technique what we used to do was the applanation, that's the contact tonometry. It is, you put the ultrasound probe directly onto the corneal surface after putting a topical anesthesia, can be done in a sitting and supine position as well. It can be slit lamp mounted, but even in the most experienced hand, some compression of the cornea is unavoidable, which can lead to error of about 0.14 millimeter to 0.28 millimeter. So that's almost a 25% error, and that can lead to post-operative unsatisfied patients. Now, these are the principles of A scan, and I'll skip these because of paucity of time. But immersion technique is what the technique is used with the A-scan. You're using a small scleral shell which is placed between the lids and filled with the saline. The probe is immersed into the fluid. It is more accurate because there is no corneal touch, hence corneal compression is avoided. You have to get the patient in a supine position, and it is cumbersome to use, and there is a little bit of patient discomfort once you're using the immersion technique. But that's whoever is using a contact A-scan should now be assured that that's not the way to go forward, and the immersion technique should be used, and there's no question about using a contact tonometry. Coming down to the right A-scan, you need to look at the cost. There's a cost of the Prager shell, that's the immersion shell what I talked about, the cost of the probe, there should be a light fixation in the probe so that the eye is not moving around and the patient looks into the light, and you should, as everybody had pointed out, look at the after-sales service, the maintenance, the AMCs. There are various available in the market, the Sonomed, I'll just skip through these, the DGH, the Tomy, you need to look what fits into your practice better and take it on from there. The Myobendix one is an Indian one, which is good, cost-effective one, and we're using it for quite a few of our community what patients. Then comes the optical biometers. They're based on the, basically the IonMaster is based on the partial coherence interferometry, whereas the LensStar is based on the low coherence optical reflectometry, and there are different wavelengths of light which are being used. Advantages of an optical biometer is that they're easy to, and technician independent, the non-contact, no water bath is required, more reliable for silicon-filled eyes, accurate with the latest formulas because they come with the formulas and you don't have to buy them. You keep on getting updates because they're computer-based, so you can actually update the formulas as well. Have the latest refractive formulas, including the Hagis-L, and it is ideal for piggyback lenses if you're doing that. So the LensStar measures, so I'll just skip through these, the optical biometers. Now, what are the negativities of an optical biometer over an A-scan is that they're expensive and they're not possible in advanced cataracts, but with the newer OCT swept source IonMaster 700, what the slide I skipped up, you do now have a larger range of patients with harder cataracts where you get a good reading with the optical biometers as well. So once you're choosing, you need to see now, do you need to move on to the interferometry based or the optical swept source based, which are now coming into the market in a big way. Now you also have to match an appropriate formula with that. So that was the third thing which I would be talking about. So the axial length, if it is less than 20 millimeters, you should use a Holiday 2 or a Hoffer Q formula. If it's 20 to 22, a Hoffer Q formula is ideal. Otherwise, a SRKT or a Holiday is the best, which works for average sized eyes. Anybody who has a longer eyeball, a Holiday 1 or should be thought about. So there are, you can actually go onto the internet and there are various, lots and lots of different formulas which are available, and you have to see that you at least have a gambit of such formulas. And right now what we use is the Barrett Universal calculator, which I feel is best for all eyes. So you do need to choose cost versus the benefits. What sort of a cataract practice you have. If you have a monofocal practice at a starting level, immersion A-scan is a good enough option. I said that you do need to look at, whenever you're buying an A-scan, you do need to look at the formulas, what are there. Contact A-scan technique has no role in a modern practice. In a standalone busy cataract surgery practice, optical or immersion would do, but if it's an advanced cataract surgery practice, you do need an optical, and you also need an immersion because there's some which might not come. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Saurabh, for an exhaustive review about the biometers. Now, we move on to the next important component on the shopping list of most of us, that is the EMR. And we have Dr. Sartaj to tell us about the tips to remember when shopping for an EMR.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to thank you all for staying all the way till the end of the day to hear us. So I'll be discussing tips that you should remember when you're shopping for an EMR. So let's first start by discussing why should you invest in an EMR. The most important thing is that it is far more efficient because you're not dependent on retrieving physical records all the time. The vulnerability of lost physical records is out of the window. In one single screen, you can have the history of all the past visits, all the investigations, everything that the patient has gone through. basically you can go from a plethora of pages like this to something that is just one window screen on a computer, where you can quickly summarize and view the patient's IOP on every visit, the patient's refraction history on every visit, all the medicines prescribed to the patient, the surgeries that have been done, the different OPD procedures that have been done, all the imaging investigations that have been done for the patient from day one. You can have a window that gives you the brief clinical history. You can have the refractive history for that particular day. You can enter the findings for the anterior segment, the posterior segment, different morbidities that the patient might have. You can enter more detailed findings for those. You can enter the diagnosis, the prescription for the patient. You can post the patient for surgery, plan out the IOL power, everything that needs to be done. And by just clicking a mouse on a screen, you can go through all the different imaging that has been done for the patient from day one, which is a very, very good way to just take a few seconds, recap everything that the patient has had with you from day one, and it just very quickly brings you up to speed with how the patient is doing today, how the patient has evolved from the starting of his visits. With an EMR, hopefully a view like this should be a thing of the past. The American Medical Association in 2016 tried to define what are the ideal elements of an EHR. And they basically came out that it is all about the physician, that it should enable the patient, the physician to provide high quality care. It should reduce their workload. It should be a team-based program. It should promote coordination amongst different people. And it should facilitate patient engagement digitally and maybe on a mobile platform. And other organizations like Health Level 7 have tried to define what are the minimum requirements from an EMR. And it's a very good idea to just quickly go through these to help you understand what exactly should you be looking for when you're selecting an EMR. You basically have to ask yourself, what all do I need? Do I need a cloud-based system? Do I want to engage with my patients on a mobile platform? Do I want to include my financial reporting in this? Do I want a patient relationship management program? Billing solutions, data security, how do I feel about data privacy for my patients? It has to be very stable. What hardware am I willing to purchase to have this implemented? And how will it integrate with my existing infrastructure? So you do a needs assessment. You ask yourself that, can I make do with some of the open source platforms that are available out there, or should I just straight away go ahead for one that has all the bells and whistles? How many users in your organization are going to need access to this? How much physical equipment, how many computers, how many nodes are you going to have to install for this? Do you want a server in your office, or are you looking at a cloud-based application? What devices will your people be using? What systems within your organizations that are already there will this EMR need to connect with? So, you know, and you also have to remember that forecast what your organization will need 5 years from now, not just today. Even if you go on a website like IndiaMART and you search for an EMRs in eye care clinics, it'll give you at least 40 to 50 results. But let's just discuss what are the popular options out there. And when you want to narrow down between these choices, you have to ask yourself that, are you comfortable knowing that your patient's data is not physically with you, that it is in a location that you do not even know? And are you comfortable with a system that the vulnerability is that you need an internet connection? If your clinic is functioning and for any reason there's a disruption in the internet connection, your clinic shuts down. The whole functioning, everything stops till you are able to get the internet back up. So amongst the two options of cloud-based or server-based, when you look at cloud-based, there is reduced hardware cost because the machine itself doesn't have to do anything. The troubleshooting can all be done off-site with the company itself. The upgrades, as the company is working on the software, implementing new modules, new features, they are automatically being implemented into your software also. You don't need them to come to your physical location, disrupt your workflow, and install that. There's no concern about exhausting your data storage capacity. Even if you're storing images, whatever, it's limitless. Just keep going. And it's browser-based, so it can be used on pretty much any device that can run an internet browser such as Chrome. But yes, it is heavily dependent on an internet connection. If you look at server-based solutions, then the data is, to be said, completely in your control. However, it is vulnerable. If your physical server has some kind of a failure, you will have some data loss. You have to have frequent visits by the engineers to come in, monitor your system, do any upgradation that's required. And most of these are limited to Windows-based machines, so you are limited in what all kind of devices you can use this on. it's a very good idea to get a real-world user experience. Reach out to people who are using these, reach out on different platforms, take people's experience. Because what really matters with this is not just the implementation, not just what features the software has, but how good service backup they give you in the future. Because if you run into a problem and there's no one to answer your calls at the end of the day, it can be very problematic. So what I selected for discussing in detail today is EH Note, because when I made the initial phone calls with the different providers to get information about them, this was the only company that was the quickest to answer. They were the quickest to come in and give me a demo, so I was very impressed with the service. No financial interest whatsoever. When you look at their basic layout, they provide you records or reports on everything about your organization. They can probably tell you more about your organization than you ever knew. You can look into all the different revenue programs. You can look into the patient appointments. You can analyze wait times. You can analyze every single aspect of your organization. It's very overwhelming and exhaustive in the amount of information such platforms can provide you. You have a daily report where you can know how many patients are waiting, how many procedures are waiting to be done. You have a pharmacy outlet software. You have inventory management inbuilt. You have for optical shop management. You have a very interesting feature where you can even send out SMSs to your patients, either on a mass level or by selecting an individual patient. You have a preoperative timeout, a surgical checklist in the OR itself, where you can confirm that all the different details of the patients have been matched. Another interesting feature was that you can have prescriptions printed out in multiple local languages. Five of them so far, they're working on incorporating more into these. Other advantages is that this was actually they went through an incubation program, and they were actually selected by Microsoft and backed by Microsoft. So all the data is also stored in Microsoft Cloud Service, which adds a little bit more reliability to it. It is an excellent platform for multi-branch hospitals because they're very good at linking all your data from different centers. You can access a patient's file from one center on the other center. They have a very good WhatsApp-based support group, and they claim that within 2 minutes, any complaint that you put up, there will be someone on the phone with you trying to help you through that. They have 15 engineers dedicated just for their online help. When they do the implementation, they are able to accommodate some amount of customization. They do sign a non-disclosure agreement for your data privacy, that they will not disclose it to any other third parties. It is yours and your patients only, but that's still always vulnerable. And they do provide a complete practice management solution, including, as we just saw, inventory management, your optical sales, your pharmacy sales. But what are the limitations? Again, it is cloud-based. So your data is somewhere out there. Any person can, if determined enough and has enough resources, can reach it. There's always a vulnerability that they could do something with your data. You never know. It is heavily dependent on the internet connection. And you have to purchase the entire platform. There's a flat fee. You can't say that, I don't have an optical shop, so I don't need that. I don't have a pharmacy, so I don't need that. You have to go in for the whole thing. As of now, they don't sell individual modules. They just give you the whole thing. They do have over 200 clients at the moment who are all quite happy. Their pricing structure can be based on either the number of users that you need to create, where it's usually about 15 to 20,000 rupees per user per year, or they can structure it, if you're a larger organization, on the basis of your daily OPD, where they'll have a fixed amount per 100 patients per day. When you look at, the cost, there's a difference between pricing and costing. You have to look at all the different potential costs that are hidden. You have to pay for their engineers to come in during implementation, their stay, what all technology upgrades do you need to do at your own end, what all will be other recurring costs that might not be very upfront. It's very important to do a thorough analysis of how many licenses do you want to purchase, because in the first go, if you don't want to end up with fewer, because every subsequent license, they'll probably not be able to negotiate as good a deal as if you buy maybe one or two extra licenses right in the beginning. And you have to look at the cost of maybe digitizing all your previous physical records and whatever upgrades have to be done to your own network at the moment. If you look at server-based solutions, Easy Solutions is a company that provides a very good solution for an on-site server. But again, if you have multiple branches, there are limitations over there. And any upgradation, they have to come in physically, and you might have to again repurchase the license for them. And obviously, the upfront cost is higher. They will charge somewhere between 25 to 30,000 rupees per license, but then that is not a per annual cost. That is your license forever. But yes, new features or anything, you'll have to negotiate. You might have to pay more for those later. And then they'll have an annual maintenance cost, which is usually about 20 to 30% of the initial every year. You can also, to begin with, try out some of the open platform things that are available. There's OpenMRS and Bhamni, which are very good to just set up in a small office, try to understand what an EMR is all about, what are the features that you really need that you can incorporate. You have to go through, again, the hardware considerations, that what you have right now and how much are you willing to change from that. And it's very important for, you know, your examination room setup should be such that when you are engaging with the EMR, it doesn't distract you from the patient. The patient is your customer, it's not the EMR. You need to have the room set up such that whatever screen you're working on, you can also view it, and maybe even the patient can view it, because if you want to discuss something with them, show them some images that are relevant to them, you can do so. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sartaj. Now the IC is open for any questions, any comments, any clarification from anyone who would like to add anything to it. Meantime, I have a question for Dr. Mohan, that when you buy an equipment,
yeah,
what do you think is the average life that you think that this equipment is going to work with you for how much time? Because when I bought my first microscope, I thought it's an equipment which doesn't have a moving part and it should like last with me for whole of my life. But now I look back, it didn't happen so. So I have been even changing the microscope every 4 to 5 years. So any...
Which microscope you are getting?
Operating microscope.
Yeah, which company?
At the moment?
Yeah. No, beginning.
The first.
When you said.
Okay. The first microscope, I was working in PGI, and when I left PGI, I didn't have any money with me to start the practice. So I had made my first microscope. I am at Chandigarh, so I used to go to Ambala, get the parts fabricated, get the components there. My first 2 years, I operated on a microscope which I had made my own.
My opinion is, if you go for the time-tested equipment and time-tested companies, for example, if I want to buy an operation microscope, I'm just giving my opinion, but the opinion, there will several ways to skin the cat. I'm just telling you, if I want to buy an operation microscope, I will go only for Zeiss. Because the Zeiss is very sturdy, it's like a workhorse, and it can. My Zeiss, the first microscope what I bought in 96, I'm still using. The MDO microscope, I'm still using in one of the operation theaters, one of the centers. These are all microscopes which will almost come for almost 10 or 15 years. So you have to look at a life of about at least 5 to 7 years for any equipment, for the matter, 5 to 7 years. Because after 5 years, what has happened is these companies come out with a new technology, and especially the Alcon company, you know, they'll come out with every 4 or 5 years, they'll say Centurion is there, Infinity is gone, we don't have Infinity parts, Acuras is there. Gone, we don't have parts for the Acuras, you need to buy Constellation, so all these things will come up. So you need to make sure that you have equipment at least for 5 to 7 years.
What Ajay? I'd like to add here is that sometimes buying refurbished, if you're starting off your practice, it's not a bad idea actually. You know, if Dr. Grewal is one who changes his microscope every 4 to 5 years, then you can always buy his discarded microscope
from Grewal itself,
give you a good life for another 10 years.
I'll ask the entire panel, when you buy any equipment, what do you consider is going to be that this, if you're taking a loan, in how much time the equipment should become free of cost? What is the thumbs rule you use?
Approximately 3 years.
What about you, sir?
The loan period?
When the equipment, the cost...
Return on investment will come, we should get
two
it
years.
Back. Yeah. My limit will be 2 years. If you are doing it in 2 years, it's good. The outer limit will be 3 years.
So how do you calculate that? How do you calculate that? Suppose you're buying an equipment for, say, 10 lakhs. Say a biometer, because that's not going to directly be paying you too much. It's more through your surgery. So how do you calculate that this equipment will be free in 3 years?
It will be based on the revenue generated by that equipment, and within the organization you will be able to break up into finer components that what is contributing to that, and then you will have your database with you, that what is your drainage area, what kind of a patients are coming. Like, let's say you are buying for perimeter, you are buying and spending 8-10 lakh rupees on that. What is the incidence of glaucoma? How many glaucoma patients you are likely to get? How much you are going to charge them? If you charge, if you get 5 patients per day and you're charging 1,000 rupees for that or 2,000, that is how you will even titrate the prices based on that. What is your target of breaking even on that particular
patient? I would like to interject here. There are some equipment which you would still want, and they're not, they might be, there's some equipment which you say must have. So a phaco machine is a must have, or a perimeter is now a must have. But there are others which you will say it's good to have, it's not necessary. So it's like saying having a IOL Master 700 vis-a-vis a IOL Master 500. There are advantages, and there'll be intangible benefits which you might get out of some equipment. And once you're at a stage of your practice, you need to take a call with that. Were you getting less, or you can't charge a patient extra if you have a better equipment. I might be using a upper phaco machine, or I might be using a Centurion. It does not matter to the patient. Ultimately, the results count. After a stage, you might be able to give the same results to the patient with both the machines. But in a practice, you have to say, okay, I'm moving up with the technology. I also want that, I've worked so hard. I also want a little bit more pressure off my mind if I'm using a better technology. So these also things sometimes crop up in a when you're choosing your equipment.
Beyond that, it is the joy of doing things. You know, whenever you're operating, you get all that. But if you're using the same thing can be done with reticule, and the same thing can be done with Constellation.
Exactly.
The price is huge difference.
And also, I think you should know how to expand your indications for using this equipment. For example, I do OCT routinely for all patients prior to cataract surgery, irrespective of whether I'm able to see the fundus. I do routinely as a workup. So you charge these patients for this OCT as well. You do a cataract workup, you have a package for that. So biometry and OCT, everything is all income generated. So I think Grewal has beautifully mentioned in his talk as well that you do a max and do a homework to find out what exactly the amount you will get from each OCT, and how many OCTs you can probably do per month, and you are already doing per month. And based on that, you work backwards from whatever the investment is there.
Can we have the question from the audience now, please?
Good evening. Very good and nicely covered topics. I just have one, I have just one single comment or something. When we talk about a group practice with compiling all the machines at a single center, there might be some surgeons who are performing very well, and there might be some people who are not performing to that mark. And in that process, even if your center is not having that machine, and if you send that patient to some other center to get the investigation done, sometimes there's a breakage or the patient is missed at the follow-up. So how should a partnership or a pooled-in setup should be created so that a person who is doing much higher volumes can be benefited, as well as the patient breakage in this process can be minimalized?
No, the group practice works by a different concept altogether. First of all, I told very clearly that you should have guys with the same wavelength, like-minded individuals, okay? You have to make sure you don't get crazy guys inside your group practice, number one. Number two is, depending on whatever referrals you are going to send, you're going to take that percentage out, okay? So you suppose you are going to send 20 scans or IOL Master per month, then you take the whatever revenue, the X amount of revenue goes to you, and the X amount of revenue goes to the common pool. It's like that. So based on, it's a ratio which is there, proportional to the amount of this thing. Many group practices are functioning in Chennai. There are at least about 5 or 6 practices wherein they have a common operation theater. About 50 or 60 operation surgeons are using that operation theater.
I'm not talking about group practice. I'm talking about common investigation center. Group practice is where
Common investigation center only I'm talking about. I'm talking about common investigation center wherein all the equipment are in one place. And not named after anybody or anything like that. It is a general name, like a Vision Eye Center or something like that. So that it's a common name, and no doctor's name will be there displayed in that. So they have a common staff for that. So the overheads are all taken care by a single this thing. Otherwise, you need to invest on each and every equipment. You know, technology is growing at a very rapid rate, and these companies keep on pushing all the equipment down your throat, and market driven. So how many equipment you see every 6 months the equipment becomes obsolete and you need to go. So it's important that the group practice, I think, is going to take a very, very big leap forward in the future as well.
You need to keep the patient's convenience also in mind, that if the patient has to travel between your practice and the common center 2-3 times, it may not be very convenient for
sometimes
the patient.
Sometimes attrition rate and fallout of the patient might be 30%. I mean, and 10 out of 10, 3 patients might not come back to you. So that has to be kept in the mind also.
Why it should not come back?
Happens, sir.
So I have a small point for
you. No, if you refer it to, for example, if you refer it to, just 1 minute,
yeah.
Ajay. If you refer it to another person, for example, if you refer it to Rajan Eye Care, okay, to Mohan Rajan, okay, then the possibility of patient not coming back to you is very high. Since that, I'm just telling you, giving an example. But if you refer it to common center, where no name is there, your name is not there, my name is not there, Ajay Arora's name is not there, Grewal's name is not there, Saurabh's name is not there, so it's nothing. It's a common center. So the patient does not know that it is a center which is run. So it's a common center, he goes for that individual thing. Bombay, it is going on. Bombay, the group practice is there.
And secondly, sir, is it a wise decision to have a machine which has all the features like OCTs? They are coming with OCT-A, fundus camera, and biometer, axial length is also taken care in that. Is it a wise idea to take a single machine, or should we purchase 3 different machines? Because sometimes patient sees three machines in your OPD, he says that, yeah, this doctor is having a lot of machines. But sometimes the single machine brings down the cost to you also. But if it gets breakdown, then things, let's say uh-huh. the hospital goes down for that couple of days if the machine is not working.
So I think like Topcon has a machine where you have a fundus camera, you have an OCT, you have an OCT angiography. There's another system which, so it like this, if you have to take a call whether a machine which has all these features is affordable via practice. If you already have a fundus camera, then do I really need a fundus camera with an OCT? Like, I had to buy an OCT angiography. I had an option of buying an OCT angio with a fundus photograph, which I would have done. I was getting a better deal on that. But then that OCT did not give me a good cornea measurements and good glaucoma scan. And if I had, but it was beautiful for retina. So if I have an OCT which is going to be used in the clinic, both for cornea, glaucoma, and retina, then I have to choose a device which delivers in all fronts. So if I already have a machine, then I would not buy a common one. I would not be so much concerned about breakdown, because yes, it's important, because if one machine breaks down, that everything goes away. So if I can invest, then I would invest in 2 machines. Otherwise, common machine, if it gives me good value for money, I'll buy it.
Sir, ek patient ka comment hota hai ki 3 machine pe check kiya.
Sorry, we will have that. There's somebody else who wants to ask the question.
Just regarding Dr. Ritu's comment regarding calculation of return of investment. Now, when we do OCT, the calculation is easy. Number of OCTs done in 1 year and like. But when it comes to some other thing like cataract surgery, in cataract surgery we use IOL Master, we use microscope, we use phaco machine. Then how to calculate the return of investment? How do you people, Grewal sir, how do you calculate that? Because how much is, suppose patient pays 20,000 for cataract surgery totally.
You see, I get your point. Now, when you are doing the cost analysis, you'll have to take into consideration everything. Let's say we are talking about the cataract surgery. In that, you have to factor in all the cost of the consumables, the total cost of all the equipment that has been used, the salary of the OT staff, your electricity bill. You have to add on everything. And in that situation, you will club the price of your biometer with the microscope and the phaco machine together, and then see how it is.
I've been planning to buy a perimeter for quite some time. So I asked them the price and they gave me the quotation of 15 lakhs for the Zeiss 840. So does it make a sense buying a new machine, or should I go for something which is refurbished?
You see, before you buy equipment, it always appears more expensive. And you cannot have an exact idea because you don't have the facility with you.
Right.
My experience has been that any machine that I have bought has been able to pay for it. And one of the machines which I thought will never pay for it was the YAG laser. But even that has paid for it. So what you need to look at is that, will I be able to use this tool? Will I be able to get more patients on this? And if you're buying a parameter, it will definitely pay for it. Especially then you will start getting more cases on that particular, you will get more cases of glaucoma. And more important is that once you have good tools, your confidence builds up. Your confidence in handling the patient builds up and your results also improve. So it always pays to buy a equipment before you feel you need the equipment.
And going for a Zeiss thing or a less known brand, is there any?
I think you should go for Zeiss as far as the perimetry is concerned, because it's the gold standard as far as the Humphrey perimetry is concerned. So, but 15 lakhs is too high.
It's please a very understand. High price.
Very yeah, high yeah. price.
And if I had a choice,
yes.
like, and when you start a practice new, and if you are a glaucoma consultant, you're known around as a glaucoma person, then charting, field charting is Humphreys is important for you. So if you're buying a refurbished machine, take a 3 years annual maintenance contract. By that time your practice builds up, your machine is going to get paid off. This machine will be traded off for a new machine at that particular point of time. So there is no harm. It's not an ego that I've not bought a new machine, I bought a refurbished. If the refurbished machine is coming from the company and they're giving an AMC, I think it's worth it.
And things like perimetry, OCT and all, you will find definitely indications. It is going to increase day by day. And automatically, it's like what is called backwardation in industry, you know. Once you have the equipment, your practice also will increase. Because you will refer more patients for perimetry, more patients for OCT when you have the equipment. When you don't have, you don't feel like doing it. Am I right? So you have the perimetry. Only thing is negotiate the price, get the rock bottom price from these guys, and get the Zeiss. I'm sure you'll do well.
Good evening, sir. Thanks for the session. Good evening, sir. I have two small questions. First of all, I have been practicing for last 1.5 years. I have a ultrasonography Tommy A scan. While using that machine in last year, I have experienced a post-operative spherical correction of a patient is between -1 to +1. So if I plan to move on to optical biometers, so are there any cases that even after doing a calculation and uneventful surgery, are there still any chance, like any cases in your experience that patients are having spherical correction post-operatively?
So I would say there are always some outliers, and in spite of the best equipment, there would be some cases, but the percentage of cases will be a lot less, right? So there's no perfect equipment which will fit all. But let's say in case right now you're saying you're seeing those. So for example, from us, when we move from one optical biometer to the to a newer one, our results change dramatically, right? We had the Ion Master 500, we moved on to 700. Our post-op results changed dramatically, and what we see is that our practice also increased, and we say okay, our toric numbers have gone up. So I feel the better results you give in the market, more patients will step in. So if you say that you have errors of +1 to -1, that is something what your competitors might not be giving to their patients, and the patients would actually go down to them. So you definitely need to either get your present A scan serviced, calibrated again by the company. You also need to get, are you doing it yourself?
Yes, sir, I'm doing it myself.
So you need to ask the company to send somebody across who helps you see where you're going wrong. Right? Are you doing the contact method or the immersion?
Sir, contact method. Sir.
Sorry?
Contact method.
So, as I said in my talk, that contact does not have any role. So, if you're doing a contact method, just ask them. It's another 15,000 or 18,000 rupees for the Prager shell. Just get a Prager shell. It's slightly more cumbersome, and results with the optical biometer are comparable to the immersion technique. So, it's not that it's going to be very different. So you just need to get yourself, again, ask the company guys to send somebody to train you again. You might be doing something wrong which you might not be realizing.
Sir, one last question. My father is also ophthalmologist for the last 20 years. He My father is also an ophthalmologist at Maharashtra for last 20 years. He's been practicing well. For last 1.5 years, I was trying to convince him to convert it to a digital pattern so that record maintenance is easy. Initially, I tried for already prepaid softwares, but they were beyond my reach for my pockets also. So what I did, I got a software engineer guy. I asked him to make the software according to my requirements. But as I'm getting forward with the software, I'm getting used to it, I'm facing a problem that everything I have to upload it by myself. Because at my locality, I have to teach my staff how to start the laptop and computer and how to shut it off. So should I dream about continuing it or I should go back to paperwork only?
No, I would definitely continue it, but it's a long process. If you have started on that journey, you have one person, I would definitely, because that is actually what we have done. Our EMR has been designed by Dr. S.P.S. Garhwal himself, and it's been a continuous process since, you know, the last, 30 years now almost. So it's a long process, because the thing is, if you have made it yourself, yes, it is very difficult. There are teething problems right now. But the best part is, you know, if you outsource it to someone else, you're getting a very generic thing. You're getting something that is designed for everyone, things that you don't really need. And if you tell them that, oh, you know, I don't like this, can you do it like this? They'll be like, you know, they'll think at the back of their mind that how many other people have complained about this, how well is it? If you have started this journey, it's definitely worth completing it, because any day you have an issue that, you know, okay, in my practice, this is how patient flow works, and it'll be better if I can change this part of the software, it'll make it much easier for me, you can do it. It might take a week, might take a month, it'll be a little bit of hit and trial, but you'll get it done. Because no software, even what these companies are making, is not one solution that this is it, bye-bye. It's a process of continuous improvement. So there'll be a lot of issues right now, but if you can hold on to it, if you can sort of power through this phase, it'll really, you'll reap the benefits later on.
No, besides, in case, like, even in a place like you're in a small town, but if somebody's in Mumbai, you have to teach your staff how to go about it. Right?
So the person who has done MSCIT course twice, I know better than him in regarding computer, regarding software, regarding corrections. So that's the thing, sir. That's it. Thank you so much.
That's a challenge. That's a challenge.
Is in the future, NABH and other insurance companies might actually require this. So it's not going to be an option in the future.
And once again, thank you so much, sir, for this session.
I think we can continue discussion because of the inauguration also, they have a pressure.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
And I must thank all the audience to have stayed till late part of the day. And my sincere thanks to Ritu, Ajay, Dr. Mohan, Saurabh, and Sir Taj for spending time and preparing and be with us all. Thank you so much.
Big thanks to you, sir. Thank you very much.